This needs to be understood also in our theoretical point of view. Going to my conclusion. Upgrade for the future 2017. This is an upgrade for S-Phoenix. Phoenix is going to move S-Phoenix, Super Phoenix. And there is a new upgrade. And mostly the physics is to study the jets and increase the kinematic. And also to enhance, resolve the epsilon mass state. This means we have to see, as I showed before, at this moment we have 2S and 3S states are combined. We would like to do the separation between these states. And this is the main goal of this detector. And this is will start next year, construction. The star is mostly focused on the beam energy scan and is going to run all the time in until 2020, where they have upgraded all different subsystems to enhance and to look for the critical endpoint. This is the main point for this upgrade. The conclusion. The RIG is a remarkable QCD machine as well the LHC and provide a lot of beam collisions. We have gold, that's all this energy. We have a D-gold, we have uranium. As well, this year, we are interested in the small system, P-gold and P-aluminum has been just done. At this moment, from the RIG beam energy scan, the window of the search has been narrowed between 20 to 40 GeV. And we hope that by 2019, when we go to the phase two, we can find this critical point. Something very important. The recent result from the RIG LHC and the proton, neutron, and helium gold collision provide brand new insight of our field. This has been proven to be interesting and more surprising than has been anticipated before. And there is a lot of work to be understood. Quarkonia is an excellent probe to learn about the thermal and the medium of the QGP. Also, we are preparing for the future for accelerator upgrade, Phoenix upgrade, as well STAR, and as well as I promise you that we have to watch for more new results in the next conference, Nucleus 2017. Thank you very much for your attention. I think it's not on. No. Oh, yeah, you have to push.
Now a few minutes for questions. I said also thank you for a nice talk before.
You're welcome.
Can I ask a question from here?
Yes, go ahead, please.
Okay, so first of all, thanks for the nice talk, and it's quite interesting.
Thank you.
I have two small questions. One is about this identified particle V2 made at beam energy scan, because you indicate that the broken of the number of quarks scanning might show the critical points. But then my question is, we also observed the number of quarks scanning broken at LHC, and how do you explain that? This is one of the questions. And the second one is, you also show this flow in PLED and
yes.
D-gold. And
yes.
You probably also know that at LHC for Atlas CMS and ALICE, we all present these multi-particle correlations. And I'm wondering whether at RIC you have any related results for 4 and 6 particle correlations.
Yes,
thanks.
We have also at RIC this the particle correlation in the D-gold as well. We are working in the helium, but I'm trying to, because this is not conference for heavy ion, I'm trying to make things as simple as I can that can communicate with outside the field.
Sure, sure.
And yes, it has been shown at RIC user meeting last week. And I think you can just go to the web page and look there. There is a correlation and there is, they talk about the reach. And I think there is very new results, but as you say, I mean, we need to work to understand the result. About the flow, you are referring to this one here?
Yeah, sure.
The scaling, it's working for the baryons and the meson as function of energy. And you are saying that when you go to the LHC energy, this is scaling fail.
Sure.
Yes, I mean, to be honest, this scaling V and divided by the number of constant quarks, I don't believe it anymore. Personal opinion, okay. We have to look to jet quenching, correlation, and other things that we can refer to. I think this one, maybe the most interesting here, which I'm showing, is what's going on with the FIs.
Yes, because we observed number of quark scanning also broken for phi meson. That's
yes.
Maybe you clarify
yes.
Privately.
I think for the phi, it will be used as some kind of probe. Yes.
Just short question. With the beam energy scan in run 14, you want to go below 6 GeV center of mass energy. And can you be sure that the statistic is really good enough at 3 and 4 GeV?
Yes, let me show you something very interesting is has been developed by STAR. STAR has now fixed targets inside the beam line. Yeah, they install it and they're taking the data right now since 2014, 2015, and they show some results at the RIC user meeting. They have fixed targets inside the beam line. When there is one beam circulating, they bring it down and they hit the target and they are collecting the data. Mostly the beam energy scan is driven by STAR collaboration. They will have enough statistic. It's like you are doing FAIR inside the RIC. I mean, you are thinking that the critical point may be below 20 GeV.
Yeah, I would say
yes,
so.
Yes. There is, at this moment, the community at Alashi and Brookhaven, they work together. To be honest, they are not. There is really competing. Some people think it's below 20 GeV. Some people, based on this, they say, oh, between 20 GeV to 40 GeV. And this moment, they are really, we have to narrow the window more with more observer to say, oh, maybe between, behind. I cannot, to be honest, I can say between 10 to 40, okay, and let them play with it to see what's going on in 2019.
Okay, thank you very much again.
Thanks.
Okay, next speaker is Pareno from the University of Barcelona, in Spain, of course. And he will speak about light nuclear and hypernuclear from lattice QCD.
Assunta. Well, it's Caton, it's the same. Well, you write it a little bit different, like in Italian, but you pronounce it the same. Okay. Thank you very much. Thanks to the organizers for giving me the chance to present here some results we have obtained in our effort to derive the energies of light nuclear systems directly from the theory of strong interactions, QCD. Well, it's widely accepted that QCD, together with the electroweak interactions, produce nuclear forces. But we know that it's difficult to solve anything in the low energy regime directly from QCD. We know that there is a complicated quark-gluon dynamics that has some consequences. So basically, the most important one is that the strong coupling runs in this way, as a function of the energy. So you have that. So this is due to this self-interactions of gluons that we have in QCD, and we don't have in other interactions. So if you want to use perturbation theory, you can only do it in this high energy regime. But if you are looking to solve nuclear physics processes, if you are looking to process in the low energy regime, well, perturbation theory breaks down and you have to deal with other formulations that can be, as we have already heard during this session, keep effective degrees of freedom and build your effective field theory, keeping contact with QCD, with the symmetries of QCD, etc., or use computational techniques by keeping the basic degrees of freedom of the theory, so quarks and gluons, right? And try to solve use non-perturbative methods to solve QCD numerically, right? And this is what I'm going to present briefly here. And the point is that quarks and gluons are defined in a discretized space-time, a Euclidean space-time. And we evaluate path integrals of these fields numerically over the whole lattice. And we use the methods that have been very popular or are being used in statistical mechanics also to evaluate transition matrix elements. So when, on which sectors in nuclear physics this can be relevant, more relevant? So in those sectors where the experimental data is scarce, is poor. And this happens, for instance, when one looks to the interaction of hyperons with nucleons or hyperons with hyperons. We have very few experimental data. Hyperons are unstable against the weak interaction, and, well, they decay before you can have enough data to analyze. This is, for instance, some of the data that I took from this web for the lambda proton and sigma minus proton scattering. It's not really low energy, so it's everything data, all this data is above 100 MeV of momentum. And as you can see, there are no, the abundance is not very high. And this reflects, actually, when you plot the cross-section, the cross-section for this reaction, they show large error bars, large uncertainties. And well, from the point of view of the models that that try to describe these interactions, well, they can fit very well the cross-section, but then when they go to other quantities like phase shift, they can show noticeable differences. So these models are not really well constrained. So we hope that with this numerical calculation based on lattice QCD, we can contribute especially to those to this more less constrained databases. Well, I have to say though that there are other mechanisms, other experiments that are being planned, or as can be the associated production of strangeness through the proton-proton interaction, and the study of hypernuclei, bound states containing one or more strange variants that can give a lot of information coming from the study of spectroscopy, also weak decays of those systems. And there is a worldwide experimental program, very important experimental program in Japan through JPARC, Daphne here in Italy, GSI, as already you heard today, JLab, and also in the future FAIR facility, hopefully. So what we try with this lattice of the formalism is placing this, well, this will be the QCD image of a proton or a neutron with the valence quarks and a bunch of gluons and quark and antiquark pairs inside. So we put this nucleon in a box of size, spatial size L and temporal extent T, and with some internodal separation that we call B here. So this will be the lattice spacing. And in the formalism, we place the quarks in the nodes of the lattice, and we link those sites with gluons, right, which will are the carriers of the interaction. So for numerical calculations, right, of QCD, so the theory is formulated in this space-time, discretized space-time. So we implement anti-periodic boundary condition, the time extent, and periodic boundary condition, the spatial direction. And we'll have a number of nodes in the spatial direction and a number of nodes in the time direction. So when you are studying some specific problem what with as relevant scales, you have to be sure that your scales fit in your lattice. So that means that those scales will have to be much larger than the lattice spacing and much smaller than the size of the box. And since the fundamental scale of QCD is of the order of 1 Fermi, you also want that the product of B times L has to be much larger than 1 Fermi, with B much smaller than the lattice spacing. If you are studying nuclear-nuclear interaction, for instance, you want to study that, because there are different scales there, it's not a good idea to take as a scale, a relevant scale, the scattering length, because the scattering lengths are very large, so that will imply very large lattices that we cannot have nowadays. So a good idea is actually take as a relevant scale the range of the nuclear-nuclear interaction, given by the value of the pi and mass. Okay. So the cost of those simulations are dictated by some powers of the quark masses, the volume, and the internodal separation. That means that as we go to light quark masses, the computation is much more expensive. And if we go to the infinite volume, if we try to go to large volumes, so also the cost increases. And if we go to values closer to the continuum limit, also the cost increases. So that means that your simulations can only be done and on physical values of these parameters, and this introduces some errors that can be systematically removed by making different calculations at different values of these parameters. And hopefully, you have enough values and you are working in the region where these parameters, in the energy region where an effective field theory can give you the dependence of your theory on, for instance, of the quark mass, and then make the appropriate extrapolations to the physical quark mass. And the number of degrees of freedom we have, if you think on a typical lattice of with 64 nodes in the spatial direction and 256 in the temporal direction, we use usually anisotropic lattices with a much more resolution in the temporal direction. This allows us to extract our signals in a much more clean way. So if you use these typical sizes and you take into account also the degrees of freedom tied to the color and the spin, you end up with a large number as a degrees of freedom, and that means that we have to use Monte Carlo integration in order to do the computation. And well, this Monte Carlo integration actually comes from the fact that lattice QCD, or can be understood from the fact that lattice QCD is a non-perturbative implementation field theory that uses the path integral formalism. So in QCD, the continuous path integral QCD partition function has this aspect here, where you basically you sum over all the paths given. These paths are given by the degrees of freedoms of your gluons and quarks and antiquarks. And each path is weighted by a factor and an exponential which has an imaginary unit multiplying the QCD action, right? That is an oscillating phase, and then this is not really appropriate for numerical calculations. And what one does without losing any contact with QCD, with the underlying theory, is do an analytic continuation to imaginary time. And so we convert this exponential as a real number. So the weight now for each path is a real positive quantity, and the problem now is amenable for numerical simulations, for numerical calculations. Actually, when deforming the particular form in which these quark fields appear in the QCD Lagrangian, which is a bilinear form, makes the integral among the quark fields easy to perform exactly, and then you can interpret the result of the integration, which will be this determinant of the quark matrix, whatever, multiplying the exponential of the gluon action as a probability, as a measure, probability measure. So the first step in the calculation is to generate an ensemble of n gauge field configurations, n configurations for the gluons, according to the probability distribution that I put it here. And after that, one can evaluate expectation values of any observable that depends on quarks and gluons, on gluon fields. At the end, when one computes expectation values of any given operator which depend on these variables, and the quark fields in these operators, and these operators are expressed in terms of quark propagators using the weak theorem. At the end, you have to account for all possible contractions for the field. As an example, I put just here a hadronic state composed with the quantum numbers of the pi and plus. So the second step will be to use the pre-computed n-gauge field configurations to calculate the quark propagators on each configuration. And then contract those propagators onto correlation functions with the quantum numbers of the hadron you want to study. And that will be the aspect that has a correlation function, where you create in a source, in a point source of your lattice, a hadron, and then propagate it to a sink point, and then you project onto the spin of interest, if you depending on the hadron you are calculating, and here is the projection over momenta. So how do we get masses or energies for the systems? So we write down the expression of the correlator, introduce the time evolution operator, and introduce the a complete sum of states here in such a way that the correlator has this expression here. So we can plot the correlator and look at the long-time behavior of this function. The long-time behavior of this function will be dominated by the exponent with the lowest energy. That means that we can extract ground masses or ground energies by looking at large times in this correlation function, right? And this will be an example of a correlation function. And for each time, you will have a mean value over these n field configurations and some statistical error associated to this mean value of this. And this is an example of a cascade mass, for instance, cascade zero. And this will be the type of the kind of interpolator operator that we are using. And well, that will be a representation. And this is not really the correlator. This is the ratio of correlators taken at two different time slices. If you do that and take the logarithm and divide by t, you get directly the coefficient in front of the time in the exponent of the correlator. So the mass of the ground state energy or whatever is close to the ground state energy. Now you can identify to the ground state energy. So it's much easier, it's much easier to identify these ground states because you have to look for plateaus, right? So what this is a typical signal for a baryon where at short times you have contamination from excited states because they contribute more to these shorter times. And then you have a kind of plateau, some noise that increases with time. So for baryons, actually, this is something very annoying that the noise, if you actually calculate the ratio of the noise over the signal, so this noise increases with time. And this can be seen, and this was already told by Lepage a few years ago, and this can be derived very easily. So if for one baryon we have a noise, for two baryons we have actually more noise. And then these are the kind of signals also, or plateaus, you can see, that we try to identify in the two, in some example of two baryon channels, proton-proton, lambda-lambda, lambda, and in the one is zero, for instance. So you can see that the noise is much important here, and it's much more difficult to identify this plateau. And I put here actually the value of the parameters that I used for this calculation. And calculations involving more than two particles are much more complicated because the noise, well, the expectation is that the noise will increase now with this factor A in the exponential, A being the number of baryons, nucleons, or in this case will be nucleons, but also because there are a much larger complexity in making the contraction to build your correlation, your state, because you have more u quarks, d quarks, s quarks, and naively the number of contraction of weak contraction that you have to deal with goes like this product of factorials. Just to put some numbers, so for helium 4 you have this huge amount of contractions. Actually, there is hope, or we had hope, because in 2009 we did these calculations. We explored the cheapest three baryon system, which will be the cascade zero neutron, with 288 weak contractions, and we saw that we could actually identify a plateau for these three baryon system. And this is a nice plot where we compare single baryon energies with two baryon energies and three baryon energies for this system. So we can also extract the energy of the interacted system but just by dividing the correlation function of the two baryons by the correlation function of the single baryons, which a large time will be basically the mass of the system. So if you divide these quantities and make you get information of the interaction energy. This interaction energy can correspond to, well, an scattering state or a bounded state. And how we distinguish an scattering state from a bounded state with this calculation, because they have, and this can be derived, they have a different dependence of the volume of your system. For an scattering state, the dependence is a power law dependence, and for bounded states, the dependence is an exponential dependence. So bounded states on an infinite volume, you look at the amplitude and you look for poles in the amplitude. And the bound state is given basically by this relation here between the phase shift and the binding momentum and the imaginary unit. So there is some modification to this relation due to the finite volume given by this exponential. So that means that if you can make different calculations at different values of the size of your system, of L, you can extrapolate out these exponentials and identify a bound state and trying to get a binding momentum and with that a binding energy for the system. Well, this is what we did a couple of years ago, a little bit more, with one fixed value of the mass and working with different values of the size of the system. And we identified these four channels in the two-body sectors. And then you have to look at the value of the mass. It's 390 MeV, so not physical mass, right? So we identify a bound state for the neutron-proton, for the neutron-neutron channel, for the lambda-lambda, for the cascade-cascade. And it's actually, this is compatible with what effective field theories have for the physical. They also obtain a bound state for the cascade-cascade for the physical value of the pion masses. And for the lambda-lambda, we combined this result we had with determinations from other groups, other collaborations, the Japanese collaboration, for instance, HAL-QCD, in order to try to make an extrapolation to the physical pion mass. And we found that we found like a very weakly bound state at the physical value of the pion mass, or it could be either a weakly bound state or a near resonance state. Okay, we don't know what is the form of this extrapolation, or how the binding energy depends on the quark masses. So we had to guess a little bit to plausible kind of extrapolation for that. So going beyond A equal to 2 was very expensive for the kind of mass, quark masses, for the type of quark masses we were using at the time of lattice we were using. So, and we knew that we needed lots of resolution because energy splittings are small in nuclear physics, so we need to go to cheaper calculation. Cheaper calculations means heavier masses. And then we move to calculations at the SU3 flavor symmetric point, that all quarks have the same mass. So all baryons will end up with the same mass at the end, and with different values of the lattice sizes. With that, and we try to perform calculations for, apart from the one-body, two-body systems, three-body systems, and four-body systems, and we classify these states following angular, total angular momentum, projections, strangeness, baryon number, isospin projection, and parity. So we read the quantum numbers that we use to classify our different hadronic wave functions. And we put in this table, you see a label. This is just one possible component of the hadronic level wave function, right? So any state that has the same quantum numbers will fall into each of these lines. And this will be the local SU3 IREPS that will give you these hadronic states. So when we perform this calculation, so we got plateaus also. Not very nice because, I mean, we are increasing the number of particles and the thing is getting more noisy, but we could see some signals for this, for the energy, so the binding energies for this system. We identify, for instance, different, I will show later a table with the whole results, some energy, negatively energy shifted states, so binding bound states for some systems. There is no electromagnetic interaction in this calculation yet. So this is just a strong interaction. And this is a summary of the values of the binding energy. So this is minus the binding energy for these three sectors, strangeness 0, minus 1, or minus 2, for the two-body systems, three-body systems, and four-body systems. Again, this is SU3, so that means 800 MeVs of the pion mass. This is just to show that it's feasible to perform lattice calculation of these systems. at that given enough resources, we can go down in mass, okay? And so for those systems, you can see that the behavior is quite different from what we found in nature, because we find that all the channels mostly are bound, right? We know that this doesn't happen. And we also find things like, for example, for a hypertriton. So if you know a little bit about the systems of the bound state, the ground state is a 1/2 plus state and a 3/2 state. So it gets the other way around. But that means that both states show as bound states in the calculation. And we also get, of course, the lambda-lambda, or states with the number, quantum numbers of the edge divariant, very deeply bound, etc. And I have to, do I have 1-2 minutes to show results for the magnetic moments, or 1.5 minutes? Okay, so 1.5. Okay, I just wanted to show you that we use these systems to calculate also magnetic moments of light nuclei, also these unphysical body required masses, by using the method of the background magnetic field. So we use a magnetic field, uniform magnetic field in the Z direction. You have to think of a torus in the spatial direction and then a magnetic field in the Z direction. And we know how the energy of the system of the hadron under a uniform magnetic field depends on the field. And so we have it's a non-relativistic hadron. We have the mass, we have the Landau levels, we have the interaction of the field with the magnetic moment and higher order contributions. So we can evaluate the energy for the hadron, for your system, with a positive, maximally projected spin and minus J. And if we do that with this formula, we get that the linear term in V is precisely the magnetic moment. So if we can extract from our calculations the delta E, we can fit these values and extract a value of the magnetic moment. And this is what I'm showing here, and this is my last transparency for results. That is the magnetic moment in lattice nuclear magnetons, some people call it natural nuclear magnetons. That means that it's like the nuclear magneton, but we use the mass of the nucleon derived in the lattice, which is the normal thing. If we do that, we see that the results nicely compared to experiment. Experiment is the dashed red line. This is the physical quark mass value. So this is directly the experiment, and this is the magnetic moments we obtain in our simulation, on our calculation. And also here, I'm plotting the difference between our results and the shell model predictions for these magnetic models. And we see that they have the same trends that you find in experiments. So this is very encouraging, and that makes us think that we can continue the program and now, perform the same kind of calculations, or always with just a few nucleons, right? But with lighter values of the quark masses. So we are now completed calculations at 430 MeV and ongoing calculation of 300 MeV. And this will start being in the area with effective field theories can help us in doing the extrapolation of our quantities. And so chiral extrapolations could be feasible. And also, we are also performing calculations we're trying to perform calculations at different and close to the continuum.
Okay, good. Now, my question is, do you have some new theoretical result on the oil state of carbon that they were also calculated on the lattice? Do you have some progress
This was performed by the Jülich group, right? Yeah. By Meissner, Ulf Meissner. I don't know if they produce anything.
So, but you're not working in this?
No, thing. I'm not working, unfortunately. Maybe okay, you have more connection with that.
Okay, very good.
Sorry. You will have some.
So, it's a wrong
question. So, speaker.
I just want to know, in your magnetic moment calculations, the masses that is entering, are they the masses generated by your lattice calculation? Are the ones which are obtained by extrapolating it to physical pion masses?
No, those are This calculation is done in the SU3 flavor, right? So this is 800 MeV. So when we perform the calculation, this is a calculation with 800 MeV, and they are normalized to 800 MeV in this way. The result that we get for the variant at 800 MeV. And this, I mean, it will not make any sense to normalize and to give it in physical nuclear magnetos, because then you will have very different results that you cannot compare with. Can you use the microphone? I mean, I'm getting deaf, and I don't really.
How to understand large binding energies for large quark masses? Naively, one would expect that you have a short-range attraction that competes with short-range repulsion, and it gets killed there. There's no room for it to win.
Well, that could be. I mean, we don't really understand that. I mean, we know what happens, and we know that the situation is very different. And we actually, in order to answer this question, I think that we will have to look what happens at different values of the quark masses and see what will be the physical reason for that. Yeah, but this is what has... It's true that it seems that the short attraction is much more important than what it could be, should be. Short-range attraction.
Okay, thank you. Thanks again. Okay, we go to the last talk of the session, and it is given by Coraggio Luigi from INFN Napoli, here in Italy, of course. Chiron, and the title is Chiron, Nucleon, Nucleon Forces, and Nuclear Structure Calculation. So don't leave before the end. At the end, there will be an announcement. Important?
Pronto? Sì, okay. Okay. First of all, I'm very grateful to the organizer for giving me the opportunity to present some results that we have obtained about calculation, nuclear structure calculations using chiral nucleon-nucleon forces. And let me first acknowledge my co-workers, Jeremy Holt and University of Washington, Nunzio Itaco in Naples, Rupert McLeod and Francesca Sammaruca in Idaho, and Laura Marcucci in Pisa. And we can picture our world as a sort of onion, where inside every leaves of this onion lives a certain portion of the observable world. And the leaves are separated by different energy scales. We have molecular physics, atomic physics, nuclear physics, and enlarging the scale and the energy scale, we have more fundamental physics. This kind of separation of scales can be seen also in nuclear physics, in the sense that if we deal with high energy energy scales, such as around 1 GeV, we have to deal with the QCD, whose basic degrees of freedom are the quarks, and that interacts among them with the gluons. However, nuclear physics, I mean the physics of nuclear, deals with a lower energy scale, around MeV, and in this portion of the of our world, I mean, the relevant degrees of freedom are different. We can deal only with the nucleons seen as point-like particles, pions, deltas, and so on. So there has been a much excitement during the last 15 years because the advent of chiral neuron potential has provided a more fundamental tool in order to investigate the properties of nuclear systems, starting from a theory that is well grounded on QCD, that is basic theory for nuclei. And let's say that the starting point is the so-called Weinberg's theorem. The idea is to write down the most general possible Lagrangian that preserves the same symmetry and the same properties of the original one, I mean, of the underlying physics of the original Lagrangian, of the QCD Lagrangian, and then to perform a sort of perturbation expansion in our world where the degrees of freedom now they move from quarks and gluons to pions, deltas, and nucleons. So what we do is to identify the relevant degrees of freedom of our systems that are nucleon, pions, and deltas, as I said, and the symmetries of the problem, the chiral symmetry, build up the most general Lagrangian consistent with these constraints, and then perform a perturbative expansion of this Lagrangian for momentum that are below a certain cutoff that is fixed from the separation scale of our problem. Then the low energy constants that characterize the Lagrangian are fixed by the renormalization procedure on the observables. The most maybe relevant feature of chiral forces is that this theory provides many body forces, aside the two nucleon force, on an equal footing, in the sense that the low energy constants that have been fixed in order to define the two nucleon force are the same that need to be used in the to define the three nucleon forces. And the three nucleon forces, as you can see in this expansion, they come out already at to the next leading order of the perturbative expansion. And as I said, the parameters that comes in the definition of the three nucleon forces are consistent the same in two nucleons and three body forces. Now, a main issue is that the chiral perturbation theory introduces a cutoff, and the calculated observables, they depend on the choice of the cutoff. However, all the observables are independent, are reproduced independently from the choice of the cutoff because of the renormalization procedure. Now the question is, the cutoff independence is well preserved for two and three nucleon system. But what about the many body systems? And infinite nuclear matter is an interesting environment in order to study the dependence on the cutoff, and so the reliability of the theory. So what we start to do is to calculate the infinite nuclear matter equation of state starting from chiral two and three nucleon forces defined with different cutoffs. And in order to do this, we have performed a Goldstone expansion of the binding energy per nucleon of the infinite nuclear matter up to third order in the energy. There are several papers during last years they came out about this topic, the calculation of equation state using chiral forces, and here I quote only a few of them, but there are many more of them. These are the diagrams we include in our perturbative expansion up to third order, as I said. And what we are going to use is different chiral potential with different cutoffs from 500 MeV up to 414 MeV. And the shape of the cutoff is consistent with the choice of the cutoff itself. Here I present a few results of the reproduction of phase shift using the three different potentials I mentioned. And as you can see, all of them, they reproduce exactly the same physics, at least for the two neutron system. Aside of the entry and low potential, we take into account also the three-body force defined up to N2 LO, to leading order. And these are the diagrams that comes out from the perturbative expansion of the chiral Lagrangian. They bring also two more coefficients that corresponds to the contact, and I'm sorry, there is their mistake, this is one Poisson exchange term that needs to be adjusted on the physics of the three nucleon system. More precisely, they need to be fixed on the, in order to reproduce the binding energy of the triton. As you can see, we have an infinite number of couples of CD and CE constant that corresponds to the contact element, the one Poisson exchange term in the N2 LO three-body potential. And this multiplicity is broken if we take into account also to reproduce the gamma of Teller matrix elements of the muon capture in hydrogen 2 and helium 3 in the three nucleon systems. So we have fixed values of the CD and CE fixed on the properties of the three nucleon system. In order to take into account in our calculation of the three nucleon forces, we have introduced a density dependent to body potential that has been derived by Jeremy Holter, Norbert Kaiser, and Wolfram Weise. And in this way, we sum up over the old states below the Fermi subspace of one of the incoming and outcoming particle lines, and we obtain a potential that depends on the Fermi surface, on the momentum of the chosen Fermi surface. So aside of the diagrams I presented before, we introduce also these diagrams that take into account of the three body forces. Let's start first with the equation state of the infinite neutron matter, that it's very important, because in pure neutron matter, the contact interaction and the one Poisson exchange term, they do not contribute. So it means the low energy constant that has been fixed only at two-body level, they are the only one that comes in our calculation. And so the equation of states, they do not depend from the additional low energy constants that should be fixed for the three-body force. That's why it's very interesting. First of all, let's give a look to the perturbative properties of our calculation. As you can see, we have reported the results at first order, second order, third order, and also the Padé approximant result to one, in order to have a guidance to understand what is the quality of our perturbative expansion. And as you can see, the third order and the Padé to one, they are very, very close. So leading to, we are confident that our results are perturbative. I have to tell you also that this is the most difficult case, in the sense the hardest interaction from the perturbative point of view is the one with the cutoff at 500 MeV. So this is the worst results we have obtained from the perturbative point of view. These are results also including the three-body effect. You see that the equation state changes in slopes. And however, the perturbative expansion still preserves a good character. And finally, we have calculated the infinite equation, the equation state for infinite neutron matter with all of three chiral potential with different cutoffs. And as you can see, what is the most interesting result is that without including three body forces effect, at the level only of two body force, we can see that the independence of the cutoff is broken for in a high density regime, as you can see. The highest is the density of the neutron matter. The worst is the comparison between different equation of state for neutron matter. While introducing the three-body forces, all of them, they lie one on another, and the slope are quite different, in the sense that you have a steeper dependence on rho with the three-body forces. Let's move now to the equation of state of symmetric infinite nuclear matter. Again, here I report the results that we have obtained with N3LO and cutoff 500 MeV for first order, second order, third order, and PAD. As you can see, we have even a better perturbative approach with for symmetric nuclear matter. And introducing three-body effects, still you see that we have no saturation point without a three-body force. And the three-body force is needed in order to have an equation state that saturates, maybe at the right point, but not with the correct binding energy per nucleon, as you can see. However, still the perturbative behavior of our calculation is still good. These are the results we obtained comparing different cutoff and different equation of state. As you can see, the cutoff independence is now is broken, in the sense that still we have, even with three body forces, a different equation of state for different cutoffs. Let's say that the lowest is the cutoff, they are closest in the shape, while the equation state calculated with 500 MeV potential, as you can see, lies far away from the other one. And let's say that maybe here is crucial what has been left out from our perturbative expansion. I mean, the real three-body force diagrams that we have in mind to calculate in a close future. These are the contribution of each term of our perturbative expansion using only two neutron forces with different cutoff. As you can see, I mean, the perturbative contribution, they are very different when you consider different cutoffs. And this happens also when you deal with a three-body force too. Here, in this picture, I've also reported, in order to compare with some physics, the symmetry energy using the cutoff lambda equal to 414 MeV. And as you can see, we get the symmetry energy at empirical value, and also the compression factor very close to the one that are considered the empirical values nowadays. This is the end of the first part of my talk, when the one part that deals only with the infinite nuclear matter. And the remarks are that Chiral potential, they exhibit, however, a perturbative behavior both for infinite neutron nuclear matter, no matter if you deal with two plus three-body forces. And while the infinite neutron matter shows a substantial regulator independence when including the three neutron forces, this does not happen anymore with the symmetric nuclear matter. The perspective is to understand why does it happen, if we need to improve the perturbative expansion of the equation of state, or we need to include a higher order three-body force, I mean N3 low three-body force, or if it's needed to include even four-body force effects. We still don't know, but these are the open question of our calculation. Let's move now to the application for finite nuclei that, as I said, has been exploited during the last 15 years.
I showed only a few of the most recent one, as you can see. And these are the results obtained using chiral potentials with two entry body forces. As you can see, the reproduction of ground state energies and radio using chiral potential is quite good when compared with the experimental values. Also here, this is a calculation using the entry and low 500 MeV using the ab initio method of non-Gaussian model. You see that the reproduction, when including the three nuclear forces, it's quite good for a light system of the P shell. Especially here, you see that there is this strong inversion using only two nuclear forces for boron 10. This problem is healed when introducing the three body force aside the two body one. In our calculation, we use the so-called realistic shell model, where the starting point is to take into account of a realistic potential, in this case, a chiral nuclear potential, then derive an effective shell model among Hamiltonian by way of the many-body perturbation theory. And then the calculations are performed using, as ingredients of the shell model calculation, only theoretical quantities derived from the theory. I mean, single particle energies, two-body matrix elements, and one-body transition operators, and so on. The approach is the very well-known approach introduced by Tom Fu and co-workers during the 70s of the so-called folded diagram expansion of the effective shell model effective Hamiltonian that takes into account of the corpolarization of the degrees of freedom that are outside of the chosen model space. And what we do in our calculations to calculate the Q-box, that is the core of our derivation, we calculate diagrams up to third order in perturbation theory, then we calculate the pandemic approximate out of Q-box in order to have a better estimate of the value to which the perturbation theory should converge, and we include enough intermediate states that our effective Hamiltonian does not depend on them anymore. This is only a glimpse of how many diagrams we include in our in the calculation of the effective Hamiltonian. And we have performed also a benchmark calculation compared with the results of an ab initio one, the non-Gaussian model calculation for P shell nuclei. In order to do this, however, we have started from a purely intrinsic many-body Hamiltonian in order to avoid the center of mass spurious motion that comes in when you take into account, excuse me, of the harmonic oscillator potential. As you can see, we have a flat dependence of the chosen oscillator parameter in order to, when we expand our effective shell model Hamiltonian, and the results, these are the absolute values obtained for lithium 6, are very close to the one obtained by no core shell model. Also, the excited spectra of the boron 10 are in a good agreement with the results only at only a level of two body force with the one obtained with the no core shell model. Finally, I want to show you results when what does it happen when we include also in our calculation of the three body force. As you can see, for systems where the situation was not so bad, it doesn't change that much, and there is not that big improvement of including three body forces. But when we deal with systems like boron 10 or carbon 12, there is a strong effect coming from the inclusion of three body forces. Let's say that we are not able to get the right ground state for boron 10, but we are very close to it. This is obtained both with the 500 MeV chiral potential and also with the one at 414 MeV. And finally, this is my last sentence, and I finished it. These are results obtained for the chain of oxygen isotope, both for ground state and excited first 2 plus excited state. As you can see, the results show that while using only a 2 nucleon force, you see that you, for the ground, you are very far away from getting the right 2 neutron separation energy, especially you are far away from getting the oxygen 26 unbound respect to oxygen 24. Including the 3 body forces, we improve the description of the 2 neutron forces that it seems that are needed in order to get correct behavior of the ground state energy of finite nuclei. Even we don't get the experimental results, we are very, very close to it, I mean, in respect with using only 2 body force. While for the excited states, results are there not so much different using both 2 or 2 plus 3 body forces effects. These are my concluding remarks. The agreement with experimental data and with the ab initio methods seems to testify the reliability of microscopic Shell model calculation with current potential. Pure 3 body forces contribute positively to the improvement of our theoretical results. One should also investigate the role of 3 body correlations in the derivation of the effective Hamiltonian. I mean, for Hamiltonians that should be tailored for many valence nucleon system. And moreover, we expect to perform more benchmark calculations with ab initio methods and other many-bodied approaches. Thank you very much for your attention.
Questions? Slowly.
You use 3 different cutoff for nuclear force, right? Do you do any renormalization for such?
No. We are using directly the potential. Okay. We don't use any below K or SRG. In order to understand better the.
Yes. But the result is sensitive to the cutoff.
Yeah.
And if you did some renormalization for the SRG or G matrix, so and with the cutoff, for example, 1 GeV, and compare the result.
I see. Well, this could be interesting to see what happens, yeah.
And when you calculate the lithium 6,
yeah.
You use the 414 cutoff. And did you calculate with different for the 450 and the 500?
Yeah, we did. I mean, we get very close results each other for lithium-60.
Yes, and one more question. When you calculate the lithium-6 and you need the, with the calcium to calculate, you need the single particle levels, right?
Yeah.
And the levels from data or from
calculation? No, data. You cannot, because I mean you have resonances for helium 5 and lithium 5, and so we use only theoretical. As I said, we use only theoretical ingredients.
So model
comes out from the
relation. From the model.
Yeah.
Yes. Okay.
In principle, you expect that in effective theories, the interactions are density dependent. However, you fit your things to small nuclei and keep them density independent.
Yeah.
But then you said something about adding in addition a density dependent 3 body force. I don't quite understand how this can be done consistently.
The density dependent 2 body force. Is a way to take into account of 3 body forces that comes out from the chiral perturbation theory. Let's say that we include all diagrams, three-body level, that you average on one of the external particles, summing up on all the states below the Fermi momentum that you have chosen to calculate your equation of state.
The case for the three-body force, at least the spectrum, was not great. I mean, some of the levels actually were worse.
Let's say that what is crucial to understand if you have an improvement, such as for boron 10 or carbon 12, that it seems that
if you have a cutoff, you need to vote in 300.
Moreover, the fact that I don't include completely the three-body force in my calculation, I take something, but not everything that I need.
Okay.
I'm sorry.
They're here?
Yeah.
Luigi, very nice talk. You mentioned that you had this slide where you showed that the cutoff dependence of the neutron equation of state was being removed by adding the three nucleon force.
Yeah, for neutron matter, yes.
Yeah, for neutron matter. So this is puzzling to me because the interaction you're including is the C1, C3, C4 term, which does not know anything about the cutoff dependence of the two nucleon force.
Yeah.
So let me give you an alternative explanation of what's going on.
Yeah.
What's going on is this three nucleon force that you're introducing has a very strong repulsive short-range interaction to it. So essentially what you're doing is you're blocking all of the short-range dependence of the two nucleon force, so you don't actually see the cutoff dependence, you only see the long-range two nucleon.
I agree completely. The point is that the fact that still all of us that we are doing this job, we perform the same approximation. We sum over the old state for the three-body force effect. I think that in order to be sure of this, we need to calculate real three-body force effects, such as the particle-to-hole diagram. This should be something that will make us understand what's going on. But I agree that,
I have a very small question. You showed that there are lots of uncertainties still in your effective interaction.
Yeah.
And then what is the reliability of your cell model calculations which you have done with these effective interactions? Then what is the reliability of your cell model calculations which you have done with these effective interactions?
It's difficult to say. The point is that the potential I was using is maybe the most complicated I can deal with. And it's the one that introduces more errors in my perturbative expansion. Generally, when I perform a Schell model calculation, I start not from that potential, but I renormalize it in order to make more suitable for the expansion of the effective Schell model Hamiltonian. I mean, this is just in order to understand how reliable close to the theory. The reliability depends also on the input the input potential. The softer is the potential, the better is your
which depends on the momentum transfer. You do see contributions from CD and CE. Okay, so it's not really a general statement when you say.
Sure. It's a statement just for this kind of.
Right, so there is a cutoff dependence even there. And then, since this is a short range term, if you put these terms in, you would start seeing again a cutoff dependence, even in pure neutron matter. And then I have a question. So, in your Schell model calculation, when you do the Lee-Suzuki regularization, which is a kind of SRG, I mean, it's just a different way of regularizing the potential. Do you include induced many body forces or not? So when you evolve
That's the point. Not in this calculation.
Right, so when you evolve the two body one, you don't include the three body induced or you do?
No, I don't.
Not at all?
I don't.
So you should see a huge dependence on the H omega. Why didn't you see that?
My concluding remark is this one. What you call the many body induced is this one.
Right. I'm surprised that you don't see any. You see, when I've seen other of these plots, usually what it happens is that if you do not include induced three-body forces, you see a dependence on H omega or other parameters in your shell model expansion.
Well, if you include...
I don't see that there, so it's...
No, the dependence on H bar omega is removed by... I'm sorry. Let me go quickly. Here. If I don't include a certain class of diagrams that usually are neglected in the perturbative expansion, you have this. You see? You have a strong dependence of the oscillator parameter. But if you include the so-called self-energy insertions, that means that if you expand your effective Hamiltonian up to infinite order, you are doing artifact, then you have a flat dependence of it depends on the class of parameters you're including in your perturbative expansion. They should be inside, but usually they are neglected. And you see that you go crazy, I mean, if you don't use that kind of diagrams.
Okay. Thanks.
Okay, thank you very much again. And don't go away. Very important. Okay, I'm reading what the organizers gave me. Members of the International Advisory Committee are kindly requested to review posters. More work. The best poster will be given a prize offered by our sponsors. Members of the International Advisory Committee will be given a paper, I think it's a form probably, a form where the three best posters should be indicated. I think they are here on the table. And finally, eating without a coupon is strictly forbidden.
So those who didn't get a coupon...
Those who didn't get a coupon should get it at the table. Eating lunch, I mean.
Thank you again, sir.
Like to make it even more official, ask the organizers to agree to parity conservation on the average. So one speaker would speak here, one speaker would speak there. If there's an odd number of speakers, then the last one would be in the center. Okay, let's go. The first speaker is Dr. Shyam Raji from the Sahai Institute of Nuclear Physics in Kolkata, India, and he will speak about intermediate energy nuclear reactions. Please.
Thank you very much. Let me first of all thank the organizers for giving me this opportunity to come to this beautiful place and present my talk. It is my turn to point to this side of the screen. All right, so this topic was given to me by the organizers, and I readily agreed because then it gave me freedom to choose what I want to talk. It's a very general subject. So I have decided to include in my talk some of the work that we have done. I'm not going to attempt any review of the subject. Rather, I will speak about the work that we have done. Fine, so let me just show you what is the agenda of my talk. So I would first try to give a general introduction, which will contain a broad outline of the theoretical methods that are used to describe the reactions are intermediate energies. And in this category, I will also mention the effective Lagrangian model, which is the one which I will be using in performing all of my calculations that I will present here. Then I will specifically apply this model to describe the meson production in photon nucleon reactions using a coupled channel K matrix method, which is based on effective Lagrangian model. Then I will discuss the strangeness production, and specifically I will talk about the K minus induced reactions on proton and heavier targets, which leads to the production of free or bound cascade hyperon states. This is of interest, as you will see, because the future experiments that are proposed to be done at this JPARC facility. Then the last topic that I will talk about is the charm, baryon, and meson production in antiproton-proton annihilation reactions, particularly in the energy range, which is of interest to the PANDA experimental program. And then finally, I will make a conclusion. So this agenda, I don't know if I will be able to cover it by the time allocated to me. So you will know what I plan to talk about. Fine. So quantum chromodynamics are inside QCD, which is that part of the standard model which is supposed to describe nuclei, all of nuclear physics, starting from quarks and gluons. After several decades of very dedicated work by a large number of workers, we are now able to understand, or beginning to understand, how this theory molds nucleon, other baryons and mesons from the quarks and gluons. And hadron-hadron and hadron-lepton and photon interactions have played a major role in shaping our understanding of QCD. It is now well established that there are two distinct regimes of this theory, depending upon the energy of the reactions. One is the regime of high momentum transfer, which happens at reactions at very high energies. In this regime, due to asymptotic freedom, perturbative QCD works remarkably well. In fact, this theory has been able to describe the cross sections beautifully, marvelous description of the cross sections of reactions that involve high momentum transfer and at high energies. Second regime is the regime of low momentum. This is the problem with me. What is happening? So this is the regime of low momentum transfer, which happens in reactions or intermediate energies. In this regime, quarks are confined into colorless hadrons. This QCD coupling constant is very large in this regime. Therefore, perturbative QCD methods don't work. So reactions at intermediate energies, their study helps us to learn more about the confinement mechanism and its transition to region of asymptotic freedom. Then since quarks are confined to the colorless hadrons, then those theories which use mesons and baryons as degrees of freedom instead of quarks and gluons are expected to be useful. So since perturbative QCD doesn't work, so what should be the strategy of calculations in this regime? So first and foremost, we should try, make efforts to do better and better lattice QCD calculations, because this is the ab initio theory that tries to solve the equations of motions of the field on discrete Euclidean space-time lattices by Monte Carlo simulation. And once this in this theory, quark masses drop to some reasonable level, the finite volume effect is fully understood. This theory will provide the first principle description of the experimental data. On the other side are the effective field theories, where degrees of freedoms are mesons at baryons instead of quarks and gluons. These theories, at least in some of them, they try to, there are parameters involved, and they try to use a part of the information or the clue from the experimental data to fix those parameters. And once this is done, they provide a description of bulk of the experimental data. Almost all the data they can be described within such theories. And well, since the computing requirement of a lattice QCD calculations are enormous, so therefore these theories will always remain in fashion, will still remain in fashion. An effective Lagrangian model is one theory in this category. Right, so let me just go over to description of meson production in photon nuclear collisions. So we know that the baryons, particularly nucleons, possess a rich excitation spectrum. This spectrum is reflected in the excitation function of mesons produced in photon nucleon reactions. It is very important to understand this excitation spectrum because they represent a complicated multi-quark inner dynamics of the nucleon. And also they tell important information about the mechanism of confinement of quarks inside the nucleons. Therefore, it is very important to extract the properties like mass, width, and their coupling constants of these excited states, they are also called nucleon resonances, from the experimental data. This is an important issue in hadron physics, and it is a challenge to the theories. In effective theories, these excited states are put in explicitly. These mesonic resonances, these baryonic resonances are put in explicitly in the theory. And by comparing the predictions of the theory with the experimental data, properties of these excited states are extracted from the data. But then, to be able to do so reliably, a theory should have some following properties. This theory should describe simultaneously all the reaction channels using a single Lagrangian. This is the first requirement. Then, this should satisfy the symmetries of the fundamental theory, that is quantum chromodynamics, while still using mesons and baryons as degrees of freedom. Then this theory should have relativistic invariance. It should satisfy unitarity. It should have gauge invariance. And if possible, it should also be analytic. So K-matrix method provides one such approach, which satisfies almost all the requirements. So let me just introduce very briefly what I mean by what is K-matrix. So scattering matrix is described in terms of the T-matrix. This is a standard well-known equation. And in terms of K-matrix, the T-matrix can be written as this equation. This is possible if T-matrix is the solution of Bethe-Salpeter equation. And if it is so, then of course all these conditions are satisfied. As you can see very easily that if K is Hermitian, then S will be unitary. Right. So we start constructing K matrix from the effective Lagrangians, which couple all the channels that are included in our model space. And for the calculations that I'm going to show you, the model space consists of nucleon gamma, nucleon pi, nucleon eta, nucleon phi, nucleon rho, lambda k, and sigma k to body final states. Then it includes the following resonances, almost all the resonances below mass 2 GeV, and baryons like nucleon, lambda, sigma in S and U channel diagrams. Since we include both S and U channel diagrams, we satisfy the crossing symmetry. Then there are T channel exchanges of these following mesons, pi, eta, rho, omega, sigma, phi, k, k star mesons. Then we include a contact term which guarantees the gauge invariance of the theory. And it's very easy to see that the background contributions means the non-resonant contributions, are created dynamically without requiring any additional parameter. So the K matrix now then consists of the amplitudes of all these processes, which has at least two on the mass cell particles inside in the loop. And this is required because this is the minimum that is needed to ensure two particle unitarity. I should mention just one, many things can be said about this K matrix. I should mention for my further discussions one fact, and that is because of channel coupling, resonances generate their own widths, which are compatible to their decays to the channels that are included in the model space. This is important. So now, the strength of K-matrix. K-matrix is a full coupled channels in the large model space. It is non-perturbative. It satisfies unitarity. It is gauge invariant. It is covariant. It has crossing symmetry. And what it doesn't have, it has some weakness that I will tell you later on.
Extended work has been done on decay spectroscopy. All kinds of nuclides have been studied in a systematic way. This will be covered by Fritz Hesberger in a talk also in the parallel session this afternoon. Then, of course, we have a chemistry program. And sometimes also chemistry can lead to new detection schemes because it's also an element separator, and a new detection scheme which is related to this will be presented on a poster tonight by Antonio Di Nito. We have a very exciting program on laser spectroscopy which we are sort of starting up just, and we have beam time mid of August starting, but I'm not going to discuss this today because we still have no results on this yet. And the part I'm going to focus on will then really be the high precision mass measurements where we have started to enter the field a few years ago. One of the big themes in, let's say, how mass measurements come into this aspect is of course from nuclear structure, and one way of finding about nuclear structure and shell effects is of course by just trying to see how is the strength and localization of shells. So here I show you a comparison predictions or calculations by different models, different parameterizations. Here this is the region around tin where we have long isotopic chains, and you see very distinct sort of strong shell effects, very well localized in the doubly magic tin 100 and tin 132. One important thing of course is also in such comparisons in general that you also always want to identify the robust features which almost all the models present, whereas there may be some differences which may be due to specialities of the model. Now if we go to the heaviest elements, it qualitatively looks very different because you have really very extended regions where the shell effects are really not at one particular maybe magic number anymore, but you rather have extended regions of stability. And one way of getting an information about where shell effects occur and how strong they are can be related to high precision mass measurements. And one way of looking at this is by taking certain mass differences. This is, for instance, the two neutron separation energy as a function of neutron number, where, let's say, from the general trend that we would also get in a nuclear liquid drop model is that, oops, sorry, that was too quick. There's supposed to be a line, but anyway. So you should see there is a more or less smooth trend where the separation energy drops with increasing neutron number, and then you have sort of steeper drops at certain places where, in this case, at 152 neutrons and 162 neutrons, experimentally also by decay spectroscopy, we have evidence that this is sort of acting like a deformed shell closure. And this would give rise to the nuclei that have been studied in these two areas down here. Now, the other aspect in masses, how they can come in, you have seen earlier in the talk by Dirk Rudolph that we always use alpha decay chains for identification purposes, and that of course requires that we have solid anchor points at some point in the nuclear chart. And in one example here for the more neutron deficient cases, we have put several anchor points here in the region of nobelium and lawrencium. So the red squares are those where we have directly measured the mass by a Penning trap mass spectrometry, and here the colored squares are all the nuclides that link to these anchor points. And in this way, you can, of course, I mean, by measuring a high, very high precision, the M over Q of a certain nuclide that you have produced, you can contribute to its identification. And of course, the general theme, as in all the activities, is you try to compare your experimental findings to theoretical predictions. Now, just again here in the Zoom, this was actually supposed to be earlier, but I already explained this to you. But one point to remember is here, if you see the same data, so the data I've chosen here is the latest atomic mass evaluation published in 2012. And you see in particular here, if you go to the more exotic cases, the error bars are still considerable, whereas here, where also the direct mass measurements have contributed, the error bars are already pretty small. And the importance, of course, if you want to identify certain features, your uncertainties should be small enough to really distinguish these features unambiguously. Okay, so what can we do to measure masses nowadays for radioactive particles? Well, earlier on, one of the first things that people came up with is simply measuring a time of flight. That has led often to magnetic spectrometers. And since they had to be relatively large in order to get a proper resolution, that was always not so easy. And usually, even in the most sophisticated devices, the relative precision was only on the order of 10 to minus 6, also relative precision, and this has given some problems. Now, there are some combinations where you can use, like, storage rings to extend the flight path without extending the device too much, and the latest is sort of multi-reflection time of flight mass spectrometers, which can be maybe 1 or 2 meter long devices, where you multiply reflect ions between electrostatic mirrors and in this way increase your flight path, but still they are probably at relative uncertainties of maybe 10 to minus 7 or so. And if you really want to go to the highest and or ultimate precision possible, the best thing to do, as usual from an experimental perspective, measure a frequency, because that's the most accurate property we can measure. And this is usually done by measuring the cyclotron frequency, which relates the charge and mass and the magnetic field, and so we can really get a handle on the mass. This we nowadays largely do in Penning traps, but we also can do it in storage rings. ...of decays, but some of them, in particular bitter decay measurements, have to be done very carefully, and they can often be very tricky in the output. So, in terms of a Penning trap, how does it work? I mean, a basic ingredient, as I said, we need a strong homogeneous magnetic field which makes an ion orbit on a circular motion. In order to confine the particle in three dimensions, we simply add an electrostatic potential which forces an additional oscillation along the magnetic field axis. The good thing is the thing works usually with ultra-high vacuum environment. You have really very low perturbations, very few collisions. Electric and magnetic fields are very well controlled, and you can store single particles more or less as long as they live. Yeah? I mean, for stable particles, trapping times of months in cryogenic traps are really something that people have already accomplished. Now, if you really work out the equations of motions, it's slightly more complicated, but the bottom line is you have three independent motions where you can manipulate one without affecting the others in an ideal Penning trap, and this is very important. And it's all very well understood. Now, what we have done, we have connected a panning trap to the velocity filter ship that has been in operation at GSI for more than 40 years already almost, and you know it has been also critical for the discovery of the so-called GSI elements that were mentioned earlier. It's a velocity filter, more or less a Wien filter, where we have dipole magnets and perpendicular electric fields, which allow us to separate the reaction products from the primary beam. Typical numbers, just to give you rough ideas, for microband region cross-sections, we have a few atoms per second, whereas for picoband level cross-sections, we get about one atom a week or so. Now, the tricky part for putting this in an ion trap, I mean, ion traps work at electron volt or milli-electron volt scales, and we start at MeVs. So first, we need to slow down the ions very quickly. This we do in ultra-pure helium. That's about 50 to 100 millibar, and the distance is about 20 centimeters. So in this 20 centimeters, we sort of break down the ions very rapidly. If we do it right, they survive in an ionized charge state, either 1+ or 2+. And within a few milliseconds, we can use a couple of electrodes, which you schematically see in here, and then just bring them fast to the exit hole. The gas flow sweeps them out, and then we can take over. So here we have a couple of ion guides which allow us to transport the ions. Here we can accumulate them in a so-called cooler buncher structure. So this is really, we can constantly accumulate while in parallel we already do a measurement here. And here we have a cylindrical panning trap stack which is inside a superconducting solenoid at 7 Tesla. And there is a purification trap and a measurement trap. The ion detector is outside. Of course, we can have a decay spectroscopy setup like the TASI-SPEC system that was presented earlier, and then we can really combine the decay information with the mass information that we have to get most out of one single experiment. Now, the performance here for like medium mass nuclei, in the first trap, we can really single out the isotope of interest out of a nuclear reaction. The height of this peak reflects really the production cross-section. And then, of course, you simply have to tune the frequency in your first trap to whatever isobar you want. And then you only transport this in the second trap and nothing else. So intrinsically, such traps measurement are always pure because you always get rid of the unwanted contaminants, whether they are from the reaction or from the preparation process. In the second trap, of course, the resolution can be much higher. And for instance, you are sensitive to nuclear isomers, and in this case you see one isomer, and again the depth of the resonance reflects sort of the population that you have, the ratio between ground state and isomer, and that's just one example where the excitation energy was on the order of 300 kV. I mean, the important part about the mass measurement is this is very versatile, and it's sort of very generous in the sense you can work with short-lived ones, with long-lived ones, and of course with stable ones. And you can use light as much as heavy, and you get such information even if you yet don't know how the internal nuclear structure or level scheme looks like. Now, in order to bring us to the heaviest elements, we have used a couple of reactions, mainly calcium-48 and lead-and-bismuth targets. And here you see the measurement. That's one typical measurement curve that you get, where this minimum here corresponds to the cyclotron frequency. These are 256 Lawrencium ion, and the 2+ refers to the ionic charge state. So they have been measured doubly charged, which is, of course, an advantage for the measurement. And the results that you get out of these measurements, so the red line indicates the uncertainty, which is on the order of 10-20 keV, and largely limited by statistics. Also, this increase here in the uncertainty is due to the fact that also, in this case, the statistics has been limited. We can, in principle, measure it to comparable accuracy as for the other cases. And the blue uncertainties and the blue points are the atomic mass evaluation from 2003. I had to use the older version because in the latest version, our data are already in, and then, of course, the comparison would not make any sense anymore. Now, we can, of course, now combine the masses, so we have anchor points here, and combine it with decay spectroscopy for cases where the nucleates are so short-lived, for instance, here or here, that they cannot be measured with a panning trap. I mean, to give you a rough idea, a panning trap can still be used, let's say, on the order of 10 millisecond half-lives, but maybe not beyond, because already the slowing down and preparation process uses up a few milliseconds. Now, if we do this, for instance, this mass can be fixed also with about 40 keV uncertainty. And please keep in mind that this is, of course, even nuclei where the alpha decay connects ground state, so we don't have to worry about the details of the structure. Now, if we take this and follow along the alpha decay chain, we can compare the masses to a couple of theoretical models, and I just have chosen a few that are sort of often used in the field, so no particular preference. And you see certain things. I mean, first of all, you see, of course, I mean, here, for instance, most of the model have the same kind of trend, but you can still have a considerable deviation. I mean, considerable on the scale of precision that we measure to. Of course, if you take into account the full binding energy, the precision is not so bad. The problematic part is you can still have facts like here, where you may have some local structure effects, or even here, the model which here behaves very nicely, in this case, all of a sudden takes off. And it can happen that you get a deviation of 1 or 2 MeV even compared to the actual data. And this is very difficult if you have to judge what often people call a predictive power. Yeah? So if you say maybe reproducing data in an uncertainty of 500 kV to maybe an MeV, the models are usually fine, but it's not so easy to know how much you can trust the particular prediction. A similar way of sort of displaying shell effects is the so-called empirical shell gap, which is a double difference between binding energies, and this will produce a peak where you have some sort of a shell closure. This is the 152 neutron area where this effect is relatively small. It's only about 1.2 MeV, and so the red squares represent the data points, and those where you barely see the uncertainty, this is the ones where the direct mass measurements contribute. Here in the WINCS, we also have included decay spectroscopy just to visualize the effect. And you see, for instance, the microscopic macroscopic models here, the black line and the green dashed line, they represent this shell effect rather well, yeah, at the right position and at about the right strength. Here's one example of a relativistic mean field model in this dash dotted line. You get a similar strong effect, but it's slightly shifted. And here you have one particular skerm force where you can't really see a very strong peak in the first place. So it's already one problem where you say even, and I mean, we know that in this area, some models really have difficulties to really describe the data properly. Now, if you see how the evolution is, if you now simply take the peak here, this one, and plot it as a function of atomic number, then you see that there is a relatively strong, I mean, sort of local maximum around 101, whereas in the outer parts for heavier ones, the uncertainties are still fairly large, so we cannot draw a very firm conclusion, but it is expected that this is a relatively local effect that will not persist in maybe higher proton numbers. Now, in a similar way, you can compare what happens for, as a function of proton number for the N152 isotones, and here you see a peak, in this case, a bit more than 2 MeV, to occur at fermium Z equal 100. And again here, if you go to the more exotic nuclides involved, uncertainties are still fairly large, whereas for the other ones, we have quite nice data also from spectroscopy, and in this respect, we can pin down these effects fairly well. Now, of course, in order to push the technique to even more exotic cases, which usually means lower yield, we have to play a couple of tricks. And of course, the other big theme is combining all the techniques that we have at hand. So here you see a photograph where the TASI spec detector was mounted behind the ship trap. We've done two experiments in this configuration already. This is a new version of our gas stopping system, which is operated at cryogenic temperatures to make this slowing down process even more efficient. And I just compare this very briefly in the next transparency. So here you see the new chamber, which inside is cooled at 40 Kelvin. Here this is a room temperature version. In addition, here we inject from the side, which is really more complicated. In first test measurements offline, we have already shown that by cooling down, you can immediately increase the efficiency. So that's the efficiency extracting ions that are already stopped inside. And this goes up by about a factor of 3. And so this is, of course, a big boost, which will allow us to make a further step up. And we are going to test this gasoline beam in September this year. Now, another big thing is about the technique of measuring the frequency. And there we have developed a new version where we not just only measure a time of flight from the trap to the detector, but we also use the position information. And this is sort of, if you want, that results in a phase-based measurement, because usually we start preparing the ion on axis at a very low temperature. If we extract them, it just hits the middle position of the detector. Now, if before extraction we excite it to a certain radius, then of course the point that we will measure will give us this excitation after some amplification by the ion optical magnification. Now, if we have done this and now we leave the ion in the trap for a longer time, then of course it will make a couple of more orbits, and at the point where we stop, we will get another point. And from these two points, we can really determine the phase of the ion motion. And from the ion motion, we can, of course, from the phase, measure the frequency. Well, this in itself isn't really some big accomplishment, it's of course obvious. The tricky part is here, in this method, we have a gain factor, which is delta R, and delta R is the radial spread of the ions, which is really affected by cooling. And so we can really make this tiny. I mean, typically delta R is something like 30, 40 micrometer. And the radius, of course, is limited by the homogeneous region in the trap, which is about 0.6 millimeter. And this gain factor really boosts the precision by a lot. And in order to show you how this looks like, that is the real detector. This is the image, for instance, of the magnetron motion, where each spot corresponds to an individual phase, and this would be the center spot. And of course, in this method, what is the gain factor? Well, this you can see here. So this is the new phase measurement compared to the best version of the previous measurement technique, and you see immediately that you gain. And the gain in precision is almost a factor of 5, and the gain in resolving power is even a factor of 40. And if you really drive this sort of to the present limit, this is shown here, where we have recently measured the absolute mass of calcium-48 by comparing a calcium-48 ion to a carbon-4 cluster ion. And this allows us to measure this mass excess rhythm to an uncertainty of 17 electron volt, which is really something outstanding. And here we have another two trap-based measurements, which give us an idea that the precision is not only precise, but it's also accurate. Yeah? Now, of course, for the future, we have to do a couple of things. One of these things is to integrate ourselves into the FAIR project. And we have started to form a super heavy element collaboration in the framework of NuSTAR, where usually this type of nuclear structure physics experiments are connected at FAIR. And this has been endorsed by the NuSTAR collaboration committee already end of last year. And we will soon also submit documents to the FAIR management, so also to be formally a part of the new FAIR installation. And then, of course, the other big theme, as I mentioned in the beginning, we have a very clear idea how to build a new next-generation superconducting LINAC, which can provide energies up to about 7.3 MeV per nucleon. The idea is, of course, to also have the chance to have a uranium beam if you really want to pursue the transfer reactions, and then, of course, have high intensity of about 10 particle microamps for the typical beams like calcium-48, titanium-50. And there's, of course, a big boost to our entire program, yeah, because everything will benefit from more intensity. But there are also a few new things that we might want to follow up, as I mentioned, transfer, new elements for sure. But also you could sort of try to come to the island of stability from above, exploiting electron capture. So this is something we have in mind. And, well, to show you this is not just an idea and a cut drawing, I wanted to show you that we have already some hardware which has been fabricated, which will be delivered to GSI this summer, and hopefully by the end of the year. So this is really a cryostat and one of these crossbar H cavities. And the idea is to have this, what we call the demonstrator, to really put into the beam at GSI by the end of the year. And then we have a staged approach of completing a significant fraction of this machine by 2019. Yeah, so with this, I want to briefly also mention you the collaboration that is involved in the mass measurement part of what I have talked about. It's several German and international institutions from universities and the Max Planck Institute in Heidelberg. And then I would like to conclude. So we have now managed to introduce the technology of high precision mass spectroscopy into the field of super heavy elements, even though we still have to climb up a few numbers in Z. We can now take precise and accurate mass measurements really to get nuclear structure information. We can combine it with decay spectroscopy to really prepare not only isotopically selected but even state selected samples for decay spectroscopy. And of course, in the future, we will put all the technical improvements together.
Which I think you it provides much more stronger beam intensity. But at the same time, you have to worry about probably the heat loss at the target.
Absolutely.
Do you have any good or any idea to...
I mean, maybe there are a few ideas, but of course it's a very good point that the target technology, in particular for the actinide targets with a thick backing, is a limiting factor. On the other hand, I mean, we have already irradiated, even like, as you will learn in the afternoon, a berkelium target with one particle microamp on average, and at the GSI, that means the peak current is already 4 particle microamps, yeah? And this has really survived over, I don't know, month of irradiation in a very good shape. So I think, I mean, cooling, like gas cooling and such things may help, but if you could really come up with a different backing that would be stable and thin at the same time, that would certainly help a lot, yeah? But that's clearly a topic that has to be worked on.
Yeah. Over here. So I was wondering, for these very heavy elements, or super heavy elements, how accurate are the atomic physics calculations of the QED couplings?
I mean, of course, at the moment we simply work with singly charged ions, where this is not yet a big deal, yeah? And there the precision that we measure is still maybe orders of magnitude beyond what we do, yeah? But of course, once we come to this very small, I mean, lighter ions, or this, I mean, we have, for instance, measured this, not only calcium-48, but also holmium-163 to this 10, 20, 30 electron volt level, then you start suddenly to already come close to the precision in some cases. Yeah? But for this, not yet an issue.
If you have other questions, thank you very much again for your... Just an information, the last talk expected for Professor Morita is canceled because Professor Morita had some health problem. So to him, our best wish for a prompt recovery. Thank you very much, and we are ready for our coffee break. Just at the entrance hall, at the end of the hall, the big hall. Thank you very much. You have 15 minutes to drink your coffee, okay?